It's super important to have a getaway, place where you can get away at this point. Really, really important. Where you just feel that you can block out the world. The world doesn't exist, actually. Everything is wonderful, everything is fine. I really feel that's so important for all of us. So I'm still working on that, to see how to bring that about in terms of the next coming up in the days to come in the summer, because the today had a constellation of events. In hindsight, I'm looking back. Oftentimes, it's in hindsight when we realize, hey, there's been a whole constellation of events. Unusual events, and they all center around a similar theme. I said, wow, hey, very unusual. So I know that something's up. And yesterday, really like a nervous breakdown from this horrible dream I had. That's about as bad as I've had in a long time. I was, I was going to run my health down, but I've been able to bounce back a little bit, but it's still in the background. So something is really getting ready to take place in the world, to say the least. What a day today has been. So welcome everyone to the video, and we're in real now mode in that events in the world are the long the summer of 2017 is underway, and like I have warned everyone, it could be extreme turmoil actually. So what do you do to just get your mind off the turmoil? So I know what I can do. I just have to, find a way to budget it, basically. But I'm working on preparing for it. And it's good just to have that, just in case turmoil really, really starts, and it may, it really may. What I went through today in the circumstances that I came across today paints a picture, an extraordinary picture of what is likely to come. And it's wow. Don't be surprised. Do not be surprised at all. So I really advocate everyone to find a dharmic retreat, and then I pray that everyone has the budget to accomplish this, really. So we should all pray for one another, for everyone who's dharmic, and may they have the budget to for a retreat going forward to the summer. And it may need to be a very lengthy retreat, actually, or maybe a number of retreats, just so you know you can really get away and clear your mind. It's so important. And we want to preserve the momentum of those who are dharmic. We want to preserve that and enhance it. We don't want anyone slipping back who has come out of gross stupidity. Okay. To be dharmic, a good definition, if someone asked me to be dharmic, there's many ways to define it, but I would say it's to be dharmic means to be able to accept that you're grossly stupid and not be offended by this recognition. And therefore, since you're not offended by it, you go to work on it because you realize, hey, being grossly stupid is, I don't want to be grossly stupid. Okay, no way. So to be non-dharmic is to be offended by this and get going to a defensive posture. It says, no, I'm not grossly stupid. You're evil for saying that, or that whatever brought this to my attention is wrong, it's bad. That's non-dharmic. That's being very non-dharmic. So I was fortunate enough to realize I had slipped into gross stupidity. I was not born grossly stupid. I was born very dharmic. And then I realized I slipped down, and then at some point I recognized, wow, I really become grossly stupid. That's what happens in this world here. And instead of getting offended about it, I said, I've got to do something. I've got to do something about this. I cannot tolerate this. This is intolerable. I am not here to be grossly stupid. And so what happens, so then what happens is you really begin to work at gross stupidity, and ultimately you're able to sort of graduate, trend into and graduate into what we would call stupidity. So now I'm just stupid. But the thing about being stupid is you can catch your stupidity. When you're just stupid, you're able to catch your stupidity. Say, hey, wait a minute, that was stupid. Okay, that was stupid. That was stupid. This isn't stupid, but that's stupid. And you begin to very quickly dissipate your stupidity. But when you're grossly stupid, you cannot do that. It's a whole different story. So really, our goal is to give everything we got to be just merely stupid. From that point on, you really go rapidly towards parting ways with stupidity altogether. So that's being dharmic. And so if you take offense, you're not dharmic. When you take offense at recognizing your own gross stupidity, so we try to point this out, we try to clarify, so it gives you an opportunity, you know, to correct it. And those who are dharmic, they don't take offense at it. They don't take offense. If they do, they're really slipping out of dharmic society, culture. As Jesus says, you must correct your mistakes. You must correct your mistakes. What kind of culture do we have where we're so politically correct, nobody can point out the mistakes? They can say, hey, you're grossly stupid. That's a mistake. We're not allowed to do that. We can't admonish anyone. We can't exhort them and say, hey, get out of gross stupidity. I want to help you. Why? Everybody is so thin-skinned. They're all onion skin. So thin-skinned now. They've sort of been trained to take offense at this. So basically, they're trying to stall out into a non-dharmic culture is what's happening. And now we only point out mistakes so that they can be worked on and corrected. Not as a judgment on our being, but as a judgment that trying to change our being is impossible. And it's not a judgment, it's a fact. So we point that this is the cause of suffering. It's love. Love points this out. Love doesn't side with absurdity and say, yeah, that's great for you. What is that? Is that loving to say it's great for you? Jesus says, look, he tells us the truth and you got to correct this mistake. He says, but if you don't want to and you want to stay, that too that's God loves that too, but you will not escape severe suffering from that. Okay, so the love is there, but the admonishment is also there. And say, look, absurdity has a price. You pay the price for it in fear. And then defenses against that fear, which cause you to become even more messed up and fearful, really. It's a vicious downward trend, absurdity, the attempt to change what we are. So the Bay Area let's put it this way. The world is a cult of absurdity. Okay, that's what it is. It's a cult. This realm of coming in this world, you're coming into a cult where they defend absurdity and take great offense at being admonished. That's a cult. And they insist, you know, there's nothing better than this. There's nothing better than to live in fear and absurdity and mental illness. They think that's, you know, this is the ultimate. It's a cult. And the cult leader of this world might be said to be certain places, but Bay Area of California is certainly one of the main cult leaders. And the whole Bay Area is a cult, actually. It really is. You just feel like you don't dare say anything here. And what happens is absurdity just gets worse and worse and worse under those conditions. Like the drivers here, I was having a fabulous day today, just terrific day. And then someone did something that is just something you just don't want to do. It's just the rudest thing imaginable. You know, it's just horrible. And they do it all the time. And they did it to me. I saw it. I said, please don't do it. And of course they did. It's when traffic's really, really backed up, which it is here all the time. And you're going through an intersection and the light is green and the cars are going through that. And you're in the long line. And you realize, hey, there's only a little space past the intersection because the cars are backing up, and the cars in front of me take that space, and there's no place for me to go. Otherwise, I'd be sticking out in the intersection. So I got to wait, of course, until a space. They start moving forward so I can then cross the intersection. I don't get stuck sticking out in the intersection. Okay, that's a no-brainer for everybody. Of course, everybody knows that. You don't just block an intersection because you want to get through it. You have to keep it clear. It says keep clear, the intersection, keep it clear. So I'm waiting. This happened to me. It happens all the time here. It's gridlock, basically. I'm waiting, and finally the line in front of me moves a little bit, and there a space opened up. So I said, great, I can go through this intersection. The light's still green, and I'll get through the intersection. I won't block it. So I go through the intersection. I'm starting to, and some car, a little zippy car on the right, which wasn't in that line. The line on the right wasn't stopped at all because they were, that's the line is for exiting on the freeway. So they zip along and zip right in and cut into that space that I was waiting for. And so they made it like that. I said, what are you doing? You know, it's just the rudest, unconscionable thing to do. And I once got stuck on the railroad tracks by someone who did that. That could have gotten killed. Because I had to go over some railroad tracks to get in that space, and someone zipped in from the right, blocked that space, and I ended up being straddling the railroad tracks on a commuter track. So it's, you know, you just don't do that. It is so, rude, impolite, uncivil, just, you know, completely unconscionable, really, to treat. Everyone knows that. And yet it happens constantly here. So I just said, oh my God, can I not admonish this person? You know, or should I just do nothing? And it empowers them. You don't say anything, it empowers them. Say, oh yeah, this is fine. Nothing wrong with this. So I honk the horn, which I don't normally do. You know, gesture like, hey, you know, that's terrible. That's terrible what you just did. But then I kind of ruined my day a little bit. I said, wow, nobody cares here. You know, if you admonish, you're the bad person here in the Bay Area. Okay, it's like if you admonish anyone here, you're evil. And so what happens is you just empower arrogance and absurdity and incivility here, and that's what happens. And so people feel like, well, nobody says anything. I guess I better do it too, because otherwise I just keep getting cut off. And you know, and so what happens is you have this snowballing effect. And I notice that everybody becomes more and more uncivil. It's a rat race, pulls everybody down. It really does. And that's what's happened in the Bay Area, to say the least. It's one of the least dharmic places in the world. Of course, they think they're like the most advanced place in the world. You ask any person in the Bay Area, and 99% will say it's the best place in the world, it's the most advanced place in the world. Actually, it's one of the most regressive places in the world. It's one of the worst places in the world, actually. The pace here, nobody practices presence here at all, hardly. There's no sense of presence at all. It's the opposite of that. It's pressure, not presence. When do we get opportunity to just practice presence? We don't. If we do, someone's cutting us off. I mean, shoving us to the back. You know, it's like that. Amazing place. So, and it's, you know, very cult-like, this place. I noticed that when you try to get out of the Bay Area, there's all this emotions and inner dialogue jumps up and starts saying, no, you can't go, you can't go, you can't leave, what are you doing? You know, and it like has a hold on you and tells you, you know, you're wrong to leave. Why are you leaving? You have to justify it. No, that's not right. You need to stay here. You know, it's literally a hive, a big hive cult, the Bay Area, anchored by, you know, the various places, Berkeley, Santa Cruz, Stanford, San Francisco, Marin, all these, you know, ultra sanctimonious, self-righteous, academic kind of institutions and places that people just are sure that they know what's best for everybody, when in fact they really don't have a clue. They really don't have a clue. They're non-dharmic. They don't realize they're grossly stupid. And just telling anyone from the Bay Area that they're grossly stupid, and you know, they'll hang you from the highest tree. So, not a good place. It's a great place to leave, actually. It's a great place to leave. I love leaving that here. So, I need to leave more often, to say the least. Someone asked me, how you doing today? And I said, well, I was doing great until that traffic thing. I was like, are you kidding me? You know, don't do that. That is just the way. And yeah. And they said, how you doing? I said, well, I'm doing great. And I was there up at Tahoe and doing all this stuff. And I said, yeah, well, you're out of the Bay Area. Of course you're doing great. You can actually practice some presence. And yeah, you could tell he had felt presence, and he was at Tahoe. And it was like, apparently it was just absolutely gorgeous up there. And he just had the time of his life up there. And I said, and he said, "Yeah, I'm back in the Bay Area." Yeah. It's not a nice place here. It is not a nice place. But it inspires me to, you know, discover how to get out of the cult of this world. You know, I figure it's like being in prison. You really focus on how do you get free, right? So I guess that's what's happened. Either that or it's my bad karma or something, but maybe it's a silver lining of working every single day. So I just want to get out of this place as often as possible. You know, the beauty isn't enough here. It's not enough. There are other places that are beautiful, really, and charming. And when you're able to practice presence, that makes all the difference in the world. For instance, I was at a place where I was feeling presence, really into it, and I saw this just tree and the shimmer of light on the edges of the tree, and I just went into this deep absorption in sublime beauty, just from simple, very simple. And I was noticing all this very simple stuff and how absolutely gorgeous, and it just put me in this reverie, you know. Because I was in a mode of presence, mindfulness presence. That doesn't happen here in the Bay Area. You kidding? Very, very superficial. It's very difficult to practice presence here. I have tried, and I've tried to bring that, but you know, it's not conducive at all. When you're practicing presence, every little simple thing can you could just look at anything, and it just seems to be sublime. You know, there's nothing but the sublime is everywhere you look. And I experienced that. Wow. And it was just one thing after another. Then I saw these clouds drifting across the sky. And that just absolutely knocked me out. It was just almost more than I could bear. It was so beautiful. But that came from winding down, getting away from the Bay Area, and unwinding, and really just relaxing my mind, and look what happened. Boy, presence just came on like gangbusters there. You know, it was amazing. So it was a very toxic environment here, and based on what is going to unfold this summer, it may become extraordinarily toxic here. If you really want to get back at somebody who's super rude here, drivers, and there are many, and of course, most people here are very good people. I was treated very nicely today by a lot of people, but the rat race gets to everyone. It, you know, it drags everyone down. It really does. And if they could get out, the nice ones actually are the ones that get out all the time. They can afford. They're wealthy, and they're constantly on vacations. They only come back here for a little while, then they leave again. So of course, you could tell the difference. You know, if you're stuck here like me, it takes all the will I can possibly muster just to try and stay, you know, positive here. And it's going to get way worse population-wise. They're just frantically building commercial and residential, high-density residential and commercial buildings everywhere here. It's going to be a nightmare. But this summer, based on what may take place, it could be just unbelievable. Now, if someone cut me off, you know, like I did, cut in, like took my space and stranded me in an intersection, I was thinking like holding up a sign, like you have to print it backwards, you know, so in the mirror, they could, in the rearview mirror, they could see it, and just kind of put up a sign in my windshield. It's like, you know, idiot, you know, I should say something like, bless you, actually. I should just put up a sign that says, bless you, you know. Have a blessed day. Yeah, maybe that's what I should do. I was thinking of, like, put up Trump, you know, and that might cause, you know, like a firefight, you know, like road rage if you did that. I was told, like, whoa, don't do that. You know, that's too dangerous. But you know, that would be pretty funny because that would really, really, really gall them, to say the least. But maybe it's something like, bless you. You know, like that, have a sign and print it backwards, bless you. So when they do something really nasty and you just beep, 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 and then put it in the, you know, in the dashboard, and they look in the rearview mirror, bless you. And they think, huh. So maybe that's what we should do. I should start printing up some backward bless you signs for the Bay Area. And that might be a big seller here because people need to do something. And I don't think the Trump thing will fly here so much. I did see a few Trump bumper stickers in Southern California. They're from Arizona, actually, the cars. I said, wow, like, wow. It's like seeing the dodo bird or something. Like, I said, I thought you were extinct. I said, what? No, but in California license plates, I don't think there's, any in the entire state. Kind of weird. It's kind of cultish, isn't it? I mean, if you don't have a cult, you would think that people have diversity of political beliefs and values, social values and stuff, and diversity of ideas on foreign policy, national policy, right? A potpourri of different, isn't that what a democracy is? Sort of a potpourri of intelligent citizen politicians, so to speak, who are engaged in talking about their different perspectives and trying to come up with kind of an agreement that sort of helps us all along. So you'd have a really big divergence of opinions about the body politic, and that's the way America has always been, right? All sorts of different aspects, but in California, no, there's only one opinion. You don't see any divergence of opinion here at all. Really, really weird. Unless you get closer to Arizona. It's so, that's, there's a lot of reasons why it's a cult here. It's actually the cult of California, you might say. It's a cult. And you get out of here and it's like, oh my God, it's like, I think I don't really want to come back. I didn't want to come back to the Bay Area. There's no way I wanted to. It was like almost like a death march. I was thinking, I hope I don't become suicidal having to come back here. And I really almost felt that way. I took everything I could muster. I said, are you kidding me? I have to come back here? That is crazy. Oh, man. So, we all have our cross to bear, don't we? That is for sure. But who knows what's going to happen if what I see is possibly happening takes place. So the summer, we're sort of painting the picture for the summer here and talking about refuge, place where you feel that you just, it's okay to be dharmic, it's okay to practice presence. Okay, it's just okay to practice presence there. And wow, is that important? That is so important now to practice presence. If you're in a place where it's really difficult, that's not good. It's not good. So we got that, and I can bring in the Dharma Kings. I can bring in Jesus specifically. I've had some contact with him, and what has come about from this contact is what I call the new way, and it's absolutely fabulous. It is absolutely wonderful, and I'm just on fire this morning practicing this. Hallelujah. I don't have any value at all. Just say, I don't have any value at all. Wow. When I said that, a lot of these affirmations, I just laugh after it released this great laughter. And I say, oh my gosh, that is wonderful. Are you kidding me? Be able to say that and recognize what that really is getting at. I doesn't have any value at all. I don't have any value. I don't have any value at all. Now, in A Course in Miracles, I went over this this morning, I think, and it's very interesting because I've said that A Course in Miracles got the ball rolling, and it took us out of our stall out. It took us out of our stall out. Okay, which was incredibly difficult to do. We were really going into a severe stall out, dharmic stall out. Helped us, some of us, like myself, get out of that stall out. And then Jesus pushed the momentum forward of that with Journey Beyond Words, Dr. Brent Haskell, and then Dialogue in Awakening by Tom and Linda Carpenter. And that really, each one of those pulses brought us further away from stall out and closer to just being stupid and being able then to work with that stupidity, really get into really effective therapy, which we're at right now. And the new way is such that the therapy is profoundly effective, where the I, every statement about the I's, I have no value. There's nothing I can do to have any value whatsoever. You're talking about the I and really asserting that the I has no value at all to me. It has no value. It could never have any value. There's nothing I can, nothing I can do. I can't do anything. I can't do anything. There's nothing I can do. There is nothing that I can do. Meaning, there is nothing that the I can do. Because the I is not what we are at all. It's just a dream of this. I've gotten into that before, you know, but you know what I'm getting at. It's not what we are. And so we have to see it has no value at all. I can't do anything. There's nothing I can do. And Jesus says, there's nothing I need to do. So we'll get into this. In A Course in Miracles, I was going over, I said, okay, great. I'm really on fire. So let me go back over the course here. But what I found was, almost every single practice here, and in much of the teaching, much of it, is I bless the world because I bless myself. You know, almost I am the Holy Son of God Himself. Just for love is the way I walk in gratitude. Most all, I am not God. And we'll say there's a little different towards the end. I am surrounded by the love of God. Some of them have, a lot of them have I, not all of them. My grievance, talking about I, the light has come. That doesn't have, the light has come. That's a beautiful one. Let miracles replace all grievances. Let me recognize the problem so it can be solved. So this doesn't have I, but a lot of them have I will it to be light. I am one self, united. I am this, I am this. I am spirit. There's a lot of I being used, and that was necessary. But as you go, as when we're in the new way now, we shift emphasis and we say, I have no value whatsoever. So what it's about is to recognize, I am not the I. The I is not the one mind at all. And really, the I has never been at all. It's never been at all. There's never been any I. It's very important to let this I vanish without a trace. The I that we think we are, let it vanish without a trace. The I that we believe that we're on this pilgrimage, on this path to awakening, that we have to recognize, that's really the central delusion, that there's some I that needs to be enlightened. So it's easy to get the idea of the Course in Miracles that there's an I that needs to be enlightened. Okay, but that, you have to go through that first to pull out of the stall out. And then as you mature more and more and more and more, you get to the point where you're able to say, I don't have any, I can never have any value at all. I can never have any value at all. I can never have any value at all. And I realize it's not talking about about spirit, the one self, at all. It's talking about this imaginary I. Okay. So we have matured. So the new way is more advanced than A Course in Miracles. Way more advanced, actually. Not that you cannot get there through A Course in Miracles. You absolutely can. But the I can't get there. The I can never arrive. The path and the I and what, all of that has to vanish without a trace. Without a trace, actually. Without a trace. There's no etiology of what it ever was or how it ever departed. It's just vanish without a trace, and then we don't know anything about it. And then we realize that it was just wishful thinking on our part. It was just like a hallucination, basically. All right, we've gone into that ad infinitum, and I don't want to drag that into the flow of right now. So what I'm saying is the new way is more advanced, and I met with Jesus recently. In sort of a reverie, in a half-sleep kind of reverie. And just that meeting with his presence conveyed so much, and somehow I was able to get into this new way. I don't know anything. I don't know anything at all. I can never know anything. I can never know anything. I can never know anything. I can never be anything. I can never be anything. So it seems like these are like super negative affirmations, but really, they're super, super positive affirmations. They're the best. They're the best. And Jesus leads us to this, as he says, even in A Course in Miracles, he says, uh, Let me see if I can dial that up. Where he said that. No, let me see. I'm not finding it. But what he says is when you can say, I need do nothing. I need do nothing. I need do nothing. He really emphasized that. I just sort of leafing through and I came across this because here it is. Yeah. So your way will be different. Not in purpose, but in means. He's talking about the various spiritual paths. And he says, yeah, the other spiritual paths work. Yes, they do. But it's very difficult, takes a long time, and your way will be different. It's an easier, quicker way. And he says, your way will be different, not in purpose, same purpose, but in means. A holy relationship is a means of saving time. One instant spent together with your brother restores the universe to both of you. You are prepared. Now you need but to remember, you need do nothing. You need do nothing. Okay. It would be far more profitable now merely to concentrate on this than to consider what you should do. Do you get that? Instead of concentrating on what we should do, concentrate that we need do nothing. This is really the ultimate advice. Ultimate advice. When peace comes at last to those who wrestle with temptation and fight against the giving in to sin, when the light comes at last into the mind given to contemplation, or when the goal is finally achieved by anyone, it always comes with just one happy realization. I need do nothing. I need do nothing. And so we're really focusing on that and saying, I can do, there's nothing I can do. I can't do anything. I can't do anything, actually. That's even stronger. I can't do anything. I cannot do anything. I can't do anything. The I can't do anything. Because it doesn't exist. It's just a wishful hope that we can become. A hope of becoming. Okay. But really, I can do nothing. We need that. It's better to just practice this and experience how you feel about it than try to explain it. I need do nothing. I can do nothing. So Jesus said the best way is to say just this, and it's far more profitable to do this than to concentrate on what you should do, saying, I need do nothing. So the negative form is more positive. He's saying, more helpful than what should I do? What should I do? Jesus says, no, I need do nothing. There's nothing I need to do. Nothing I need to do. That, he says, is far more profitable. And I certainly get this. I certainly get it. It's taken me only, 40 years, or really 48 years of intense dharmic effort to be able to finally get this, because I didn't used to get it at all. And who does? Who does, right? But I certainly get it. And to the point where I say this, I burst out in laughter and think it's the most wonderful thing I've ever said in my life. It's tremendous. I have no value whatsoever. I can never have even the slightest value. I can never have even the slightest value. That is so powerful. Just if you can just say that and then just feel. Don't analyze what you're saying. Just feel it. Like, wow, it just rocks the foundations of your belief system, doesn't it? I can never have even the slightest value. That produces a wow reaction, to say the least. So, we have this new way, and it's more powerful than the world. Okay, it's more powerful than anything that can stop us. All right? When we're willing to say this, the door is open. Really, what we're saying is, hey, I'm looking at the door, this open door, and it's just open. And there's no door to close. It's just a frame doorway, and it's wide open. There's no door there at all. So I don't need to do anything to open any door at all. I don't need a key to open any lock, because there's no handle, locked knob, doorknob, because there's no door there. There's no hinges there. There's no door there. It's just a frame of a door, which is open. So we're really just seeing that open door, that openness, and say, well, there's nothing in the way. There's never been anything in the way. There's never been any obstruction. There's no I have to get rid of. Not really, but first, we have to get comfortable with recognizing that the I has no value, it can never have any value. And ultimately, then, it just, we find, we look right, there's no I, it's gone. I experienced this a while back where I say I, of course, it's a different level of meaning. This I is just a referencing the one mind when I speak of the I, talking about the imaginary I. That I became aware that the I had disappeared. I said, my gosh, I don't have any I anymore, it's gone. And I wonder where it went. I said, but nah. I said, should I go look for it? I said, no. You know, if it wants to come back, fine. Otherwise, yeah, I'm not going to go look for it, really. And then I was kind of looking. I said, where did it go? I said, there's not a trace. I don't have the clue where it went or a trace. It just wandered off and disappeared without a trace. So I experienced that, and it was kind of very surprising. I just said, wow, that's amazing. I don't know how it happened. I guess I just reached a point where I said, I'm not interested in the eye anymore. And it really just vanished. It just vanished. I didn't notice it's vanishing. I just sort of noticed that it wasn't around anymore. So where's the eye? I don't know. It's gone. Okay. Let's not call it back, right? So we're directly practicing getting to that, experiencing that, the eye is just gone, it's gone, it's gone. And to just say, oh, it's fine, it's no big deal, it doesn't have any value, it can never have any value anyway. I can't. I can't change anything. I can't do anything. I can't be anything. I am completely worthless. I am completely worthless. How about that? Who could ever say that and feel that is supremely positive? I am completely worthless. Wow. Now, you wouldn't start out anyone with this, right? So Jesus didn't start out A Course in Miracles with this. And we don't advocate anyone start out that way. This is the new way, very advanced, for those who are very, very dharmic and able to get with this new way. I am completely worthless. Wow. Awesome. Awesome to hear that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's really a great statement of freedom. Awesome. It's spreading your wings, the wings of freedom. That as Jesus says, that the breeze of God will gently be beneath your wings and lift you up higher and higher and higher and higher as you spread the wings of freedom by making these statements. I need do nothing. I need do nothing. I am completely worthless. I am completely worthless. Now, some have taken the shortcut, the Sargadatta Maharaj, just saying, I am. I am. I am. Just that. I am. And by doing that, he blocked I am anything whatsoever. I am. He didn't say I am valuable. I am this. I am that. He just stopped it at I am and refused to go anywhere else other than that. That's also very powerful means, very powerful, and it worked for him beautifully. But our way, is extremely powerful as well. I am totally worthless. I'll always be completely worthless. I will always be completely worthless, right? The I will always be completely worthless to me because I'm absolutely free. There's no becoming. There's no definition of what I am. There's no structure of what I am, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? So we can say that I am totally worthless. But that takes a lot of maturity to be able to say that. So, but for those who have a lot of maturity, this is the way to go. Otherwise, you're just looking at a stall out. Now, in the world, what happens? What's going to happen? Well, today, I had this constellation of heads up, you know, this heads up, heads up, heads up, about the Navy, about boats, about Navy SEALs, and then about a firefight, and various things like this. There's a fire broke out in this truck, and there's five took five people to put it out. And then someone said, "It's like Navy SEAL. At some point, you got to be like the Navy SEALs and just go for it." And I was thinking about the tension in the world, etc. And we know, if any of us who kind of Holy Spirit has directed our awareness in certain ways, just to be aware of what's going on. And I looked a little bit into the North Korean situation, and just, well, the Holy Spirit showed me, look at this. And I said, okay, yeah, wow, okay. It is very likely the U.S. will try what's called a decapitation strike against the leadership in North Korea in an attempt to avoid a nuclear war that way. Is if they take out the leadership and then maybe launch a preemptive attack, that they can somehow get a hold, you know, take out the nuclear installations they have, their nuclear weapons, in some way, prevent any decisions from being made to use those, prevent decisions for, you know, to launch short intermediate range missiles into Seoul in Korea, and you know, prevent a tremendous firefight of a war, which we're headed towards very, very quick, soon, actually. That's just a likely scenario, actually. So there are teams over there. We know that there are certainly teams trained to do just that, and that's certainly has to be part of the equation as a possibility. Can they take out the leadership and cut the whole command structure there, so that the whole thing just kind of freezes up temporarily, and then they're able to do some sort of preemptive situation that shuts the whole, you know, shuts the insanity down. And, you know, let's not pretend that it's anything other than insanity. Okay, it most certainly is. That place is really has some issues, to say the least. And we don't want them having nuclear tip ballistic missiles. Nobody does. There's nobody in the world that wants to create, except maybe Iran, to have, you know, nuclear-tipped intercontinental ballistic missiles, ICBMs, because they're the most likely country in the world to actually use them, and they may very well do a preemptive strike against the U.S. Actually, very possible. They think that that's probably the only chance they have. You see, is try to decapitate the U.S. command structure. It really caused havoc. And they may be headed toward trying to do exactly that. And as we know, the Japanese did exactly that on the United States. So the idea historically that doesn't happen is nonsense. We had intimation and belief the Japanese would strike us, you see, because that's how they were acting. And psychologically, there was strong belief in higher levels that it would happen. And they did. Pearl Harbor. It's called Pearl Harbor. December 7th, I believe, was it 1941? Or I'm not sure what the year was, but it was December 7th. And it was a devastating attack on Pearl Harbor. They felt it would, you know, great, give them opportunity, Japanese, to take over the whole Eastern Sphere, which they pretty much did. So we have precedent coming from the East like that, of a smaller country trying to, you know, do a preemptive strike. That wasn't that long ago, 1941, right? So it would be very foolish to think that wouldn't happen. Very foolish. So this is sort of what the came about today, of like a constellation of stuff about boats, about the U.S. Navy, about Navy SEALs, about sudden firefight, about cutting in, you know, suddenly cutting, make a sudden cut in, you know, sudden sort of strike like that, and like they did with Osama bin Laden, so to speak, you know, go in behind the scenes, behind the scenes, take out the leadership, and get out of there, so to speak. And that's, you know, that is certainly on the plate as a possibility, which would need to be followed up by something, most likely. There might be quick negotiations to form a new government and say, we will not strike if you form a new government and agree to, you know, dearm your nuclear missile, nuclear weapons to deactivate them, right? And make an agreement, and then we could avoid a war altogether. We could avoid World War III, actually, which is likely, if we don't do something like that, we're likely to have World War III, actually. We're headed right straight towards it. But people have their heads in the sand. You know, they think that the United States is the bad guy. Trump's the bad guy. You know, and the Korean leader is like, they say, well, you know, he's not so bad. He's always jolly and smiling and stuff. You know, well, those are propaganda pictures, believe it or not. It's a Stalinist state. Well, it's really amazing. It's really amazing what's going on and how people, they're trying to manipulate public opinion this way and that. The anarchists, you know, who want things to be all messed up. The news people, of course, love anarchy because it sells newspapers. You know, if everything was peaceful and calm, who would buy a newspaper? Who would watch the news? I wouldn't, you know. Nobody. We'd stop watching the news. We watch the news to be shocked. We're shock addicts, actually. You don't watch the news to say, hey, hi, everybody. There's another Pleasant Valley Sunday. And everybody was, people went out and played golf, went swimming, and practiced presence. And, wow, zero crime, zero trouble. It was just a beautiful day. See you next week. You know, the people would stop watching TV. They'd stop. The commercial, those who sell their products wouldn't have any means to sell them, and because they'd rely on people being in shock, and then to block the panic, they say, hey, here, buy our product. That'll help you block the panic. That's what it's all about. It's really an evil empire, the whole situation here in the world. And the education of this world is really a corporate education. It's been structured by the whole notion of corporateness, materialism. That I call it, you know, learned gross stupidity. It's really a cover for gross stupidity. The education of 99.9% of the people in the world, you might say. You can leave out some of the people who are not educated, of course, because they're way wiser than most of us, actually. Is really what happens is it's a cover, a camouflage for gross stupidity. It's a way of defending gross stupidity. Say, no, I got a degree. No, I got a high school. I got my college degree. Yet. And so I'm proven that I'm not grossly stupid. Well, you've got a cult, cabal, selling you this diploma. It's, you know, selling it to you, really. I mean, that's really what happens. And telling you, if you have this diploma, it means you're not grossly stupid. Well, of course, they're grossly stupid as well. So, I mean, where's the authority to assert this? Where's the legitimacy of such nonsense that they claim? There's nobody more grossly stupid than an educated, someone who's highly educated, not aware. You know, they think, well, I'm highly educated, I can't be grossly stupid. I got a diploma from Harvard or something. No, all you're doing is trying to insulate yourself from any admonishment. So you can't admonish me. I got a master's degree from Harvard. A master's degree in what? How to camouflage gross stupidity is basically what the degrees are. How to deny it. You don't work on gross stupidity in school. Not at all. Not at all. Don't even touch upon it. That's why I quit paying attention to school at the age of 12. I said, if I pay any more attention here, I'm never going to get free of gross stupidity. This curriculum is insane. You know, it's just promoting gross stupidity. That's all it does, actually. So it's not surprising that the world is really cuckoo. You know, and the people who are trying to really put out the fire, they're being vilified. You know, and right now we have a situation where, you know, you got a really tough decisions that need to be made. Tough decisions. And so, you know, we have to recognize this. It's not easy for any policymakers right now as to what to do, right? It's not easy. I know Jesus says attack is never justified. Well, yeah, from any side. So if the North Koreans attack, would that be justified? No, it wouldn't. I don't know. So I don't know where to go with that. But it's kind of goes around in circles. I mean, the preemptive attack is not justified, but the preemptive attack from the other side is not justified. But it's still going to happen. Saying it's not justified, that doesn't mean it's not going to happen, right? Just saying that it's never justified. So, anyway, it seems as though the tension and the nerves and what I'm experiencing in dreams is that really there's something afoot. There has to be, because North Korea is between right now and 2 years away from having nuclear-tipped ICBMs that can hit San Francisco, Los Angeles, Seattle, maybe even Chicago, maybe in Washington. I mean, can hit the United States, not to mention all the countries in the East, Tokyo, Sydney. I mean, it's going to be able to hit all over the place. They either have it already, or it's going to be several years away. Most of the stuff is, by the way, made in China. They're getting the technology from China. They're getting the parts from China. They're getting the know-how from China. It's coming from the Chinese. The Chinese are just using Korea to be their junkyard dog, and cause all, they're just a pawn that they're using. The Koreans didn't come up with all this stuff on their own. They didn't come up with all these mobile launchers. That's from China. So of course the Chinese are saying, "Yeah, we're going to do something about this." We're talking to them and stuff, but probably behind the scenes they're saying, "Ha, this is really causing doing exactly what we want." Yeah, that's the political. That's the political games behind the scenes. They're just a satellite country of China is what it is, and the parts that have been recovered from these missiles, they're made in China. So, sure, the Chinese leader smiling like a crocodile, I'm sure the American leadership knows all about that. So it's a very touchy situation, it's a very touchy situation. Extremely touchy situation. Because you got a bunch of raving paranoids there. And paranoia is not a good thing. I've experienced it. I went through all sorts of experiences to see what it was like, so I'd be wise about it. And it's really bad, because you're sure that those shadows over there are about to attack you. You're sure of it. And so you think that everything you do is justified. Like, okay, I've got to. You see paranoid shooting at shadows, like that is like yeah, absolutely. And they've written the book on paranoia over there. It's amazing. So you don't really want paranoids with nuclear tipped ICBMs. I don't think the world wants that at all. Radioactivity affects us all, right? I mean, we don't want to be catapulted into World War III. So if we could, limited engagement is better than an all-out sort of thing, you might say. Speaking of that, pivoting a little bit, it may be best to not push all these issues into the world at all. And as far as the struggling with this world right now, which is an extremely non-dharmic situation, very stalled out, it may be best to not struggle with it. And I want to illustrate that by one of the most important lessons in history, which is the battle for Rome. Hannibal from Carthage and through Spain crossed over the Alps and was going to take over Italy and Rome. And that battle, that long, long campaign and battle, I think it stretched a number of years actually, ultimately Hannibal was defeated. He couldn't accomplish it, which was absolutely astonishing, because initially it looked like there's nothing that could stop him. He was unstoppable. He had gotten his whole army with all these elephants, war elephants, through the Alps, through what seemed to be impassable conditions, into Italy, and was just conquering, 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 getting all this land and food and everything, and they just seemed like an unstoppable force. So what happened was this general called Fabian, I believe, Fabius or Fabian, was put in charge of the Roman troops, because the Romans were getting destroyed. And he's the one that saved Rome. Now, I don't know if that's a good thing historically or not, but that's not an issue here. what he did was he avoided any decisive battle. He avoided any decisive battle. Even when it looked like he could win, he would refuse to be drawn into a decisive battle. And what he did was he slowly used attrition on the supply lines of Hannibal and raised the countryside, burned all the crops, and so they cut down the food supply, cut down reinforcements, and guerrilla warfare essentially wore them down bit by bit by bit, and kept moving around and pretending to be ready for a decisive battle. And so Hannibal would move his troops there and say, okay, we're finally going to have this battle, and we're going to win, and that's it. And then when the battle would start, he would do selective retreats, and was able to pull back and avoid that decisive battle and inflict a lot of damage on Hannibal's army. So Hannibal was thinking, there's a decisive battle, and so let's put everything into it. And he'd draw him into a trap that way, and then he'd retreat, and he gradually he wore Hannibal down over the years. So one of the most, astonishing victories in history, that be able to protect Rome in this way. Because they were really, really outnumbered, to say the least, to begin with, and seemed like they had a very slim chance. So really, with the Holy Spirit in the situation now in the world, it's probably best to avoid any decisive battle with the egoic consciousness, the non-dharmic consciousness here. And another example is, for instance, Napoleon going into Russia in the winter. He couldn't admit to himself that there wasn't any, there was something that he couldn't immediately conquer in the world, which was the Russian winter. He said, no, he must have thought well, nothing can stop us. Nothing can stop us. So it doesn't matter. I'm not to worry about that. Well, it stopped him. Not many walked out of Russia, actually. The Grand Army was absolutely decimated by the Russian winter. So all Napoleon had to do was to avoid a decisive battle at that point with Mother Nature and say, okay, you're going to halt me for a little while. That's okay. I can handle that. I'll just strategically build up my forces even more and consolidate what I've done. And when the winter is over, then we'll take it from there. Okay, that would have been obviously what you would think is the wise move to do, right? But no. He insisted that we must have a decisive battle here. Let's push it through. Wrong move. Okay, really bad move. Yeah, the same with all these egomaniacs in history. The unwise, let's put it this way, that they felt that they nothing could stop them in terms of conquering, So we have to be wiser than that. And say, hey, wait a minute. It's not retreating. We're not admitting defeat, retreating or anything. We're just making a strategic adjustment to avoid a decisive battle. Okay? That's how we're ultimately going to succeed, I believe, is just avoiding these decisive battles with non-dharmic consciousness. And okay, so the Russian winter is here, okay, so to speak. All right, let it have its play. We'll just go stay in a nice sunny warm place, and wait until it's over. That's all. Strategic adjustment, avoiding Fabianism in terms of avoiding a decisive battle, and gradually, you win the day gradually. So it seems like this is in play right now. So we need to realize, hey, let's give the devil its due. The quote-unquote the Russian winter, the harsh winter of this Kali Yuga age, this lowest point. That's no time to try to have a decisive, bring everyone to this decision at that point, this point, and put everything into it, because it's likely to not work at all. So why don't we hold a lot of our resolve in check at this point, So it's really, really even stronger in the future where we start to thaw out a little bit from gross stupidity, and more people decide to say, you know what, we've been grossly stupid. And this is what I'd experienced in that dream of repentance. The baby boomers, they began to realize, hey, we've been grossly stupid, and we've got to look at this. We've really got to look at this. So I really experienced a movement of repentance among some of the elder people of this world, those what you might call baby boomer generation, and there may be in some others too. Really, I'm not exactly sure of all the age groups, but it started to spread like a wildfire of people saying, "Wow, I believe I've been grossly stupid, and I've got to do something about that. I cannot tolerate. I've admitted that way, so I can't tolerate. So I've got to get out of this gross stupidity, and I'm really willing to do the work, to do the reading, to do the research, the study, the application, the determination. I'm really willing to do that to at least get out of gross stupidity into mere stupidity, which is a wonderful, wonderful progress to make. So it will happen. I believe it's going to happen. But we better be careful not to force things at this point. At the point of perhaps the severe cold winter is upon us, that people maybe just be. They decided in their minds. I remember I had hypothermia. I had decided in my mind I wanted to get out of there, out of this, snowstorm where I was trapped overnight. But I couldn't move. So my mind was still clear. I said, wow, I'd like to be in a nice sunny place right now. But I can't move. I couldn't even move to do anything. I couldn't. I was just trembling so bad. I lost complete control over any movement at all. And so there may be many who have repented right now in the world. It seems like this is what's happened and will continue to spread. But they're so frozen, they're in such a hypothermic state of gross stupidity that they can't quite move on it. So we don't want to force the issue with them at this point. Let's build a little fire, so let's build something and start warming them up gradually. Well, it's not like, okay, you've repented, okay, get with it full blast right now, or else you're it's not going to work for you. It's not going to work that way. I don't see it working that way. So the way I survived was my brother built a little fire. I don't know how he did it, saved our lives. And somehow, I don't know what we were burning. I don't know how he got it done, started, but we found some underneath the snow, some dry timber enough to get a little fire, and I was able to, I think we were, was that what he did? Or was it, let me see, I think he did, but maybe that wasn't, but then I just kept eating trail mix all night long to keep my heat going, inner heat, and then the next day the sun came out and warmed up enough to get out of there. I have to ask, I can't remember. I thought he was able to build, maybe he wasn't able to build a full fire. I guess I was able to move my hands just to my mouth to get trail mix, or maybe he helped me, I don't know. But I had to keep eating, keep eating, keep eating to replace the lost heat, that I had lost. And all my clothes were soaking wet, and frozen on me. I didn't have any, I just had lightweight summer clothes. They were all soaking wet and froze on me. And so I was got in a sleeping bag and just tried to, wait, survive through the night. So it may be that they repented, but they just can't express it. And so it's probably very frustrating for them. So we have to be patient with them. Say, this is okay, no worries, no worries. We'll be there for you. We'll be there for you when you thaw out. We'll help you thaw out a bit, give you a little trail mix to keep you going here. And they're probably feeling like, oh God, don't judge me for my gross stupidity now, because I still got these habits and I'm still acting. I know I did, but I can't seem to stop myself right at this point. I'm all freaked out. So we just have to, put up with it, be tolerant of it, build a little fire, give them a little spiritual nutrition. And at some point, they'll get the heck out of there, out of that gross stupidity. They'll start really working at it. And of course, a lot of the world is not going to do that, right? They are hell bent on celebrating gross stupidity. The anarchist. Let's celebrate gross stupidity, you know. That's the answer. The nihilists, you know, all this. No clue. So let's just make it as grossly stupid as we possibly can, and maybe that'll work. I don't know. Yeah, well, we do know it doesn't work. Just because someone says, I don't know how to do it, doesn't mean nobody knows. Right? Holy Spirit knows. So I'm not the only one that's nervous. There are plenty of people that are on the verge of a breakdown right now. There's really something, if you're sensitive, there's really something afoot. And I would just suggest that nobody freak out, whatever takes place. And I know there's some whose ideology is such that, you know, the U.S. can do no right. Can do no right. I mean, they expect us just to wait until we get hit by numerous, you know, nuclear warheads. And even then, they're going to say, well, we deserved it, you know. I mean, they're like suicidal. A lot of these activists are really, they want the U.S. to be destroyed, actually. It's a fact. They're really like saboteurs, and they have their own ideology for that, and you can look at weigh that one way or the other, but certainly that's true. They're like saboteurs. They want maximum damage to be inflicted on the U.S. I feel the U.S. is the cause of all the global problems. And you can argue about this back and forth a lot. And you know, you can bring up point and counterpoint. But I think at some point, you know, you have to say, you know what, Third World War is not a good idea. Dharmically speaking, right? It's not a good idea. And so we cannot allow anarchists to carry the day, you know? And at some point, you got to take a position. It is, you say, wow, should we stop World War III? Yeah, absolutely we should. But people take that in different ways, you know. Certainly, if North Korea hits the United States with multiple ICBMs, or even one, that's going to start World War III. There's no question about it. It's not like you can take out the U.S. by doing that. You're just going to stir up a hornet's nest. So that has to be prevented, for sure, for sure. And we're getting very, very, very close to such an eventuality. So something has to be done. You know, some accord, you know, we can do it from a peaceful accord, but that hasn't worked for a long time. And as we get closer and closer and closer, you might be saying, hey, maybe they don't want to have an accord. Maybe they do want to strike. I mean, if they wanted to have an accord, don't you think we could have reached one by now? I mean, how difficult is it to say, okay, you know, we'll have mutual assured protection. There's some Korean veteran that said he was there in the DMZ, the demilitarized zone, and 38th parallel, and he was stationed there for quite a while. And he said, you do know, don't you, that we Americans are there in the United Nations peacekeeping forces. We're there to keep the South Koreans from invading the North. We're not there to keep the North Koreans from invading the South. We're there to prevent the South Koreans from invading, because they're much stronger, the South Koreans. So really, the U.S. has been preventing, you know, a war there. We've actually been helping North Korea. And if we weren't there, the South Koreans most certainly would attack. But then you'd bring China into the picture, and you'd have, you know, war on your hands. So the U.S. has been helping stabilize world peace in a lot of ways, in a lot of ways. As we know, the history of the world is such that usually it turns to warfare. And so you need a world policeman. And the U.S. is the world policeman. You need that here. You know, to naively say we don't need it is just absurd at this point. You know, it's wishful thinking. We're still, the world is still areas that feel that Revenge is the answer to happiness, and they haven't gone past warfare by any means, and we know it. But for some reason, idealists just want to say, "Oh no, they just want to hope that that's not true," even though the evidence is swirling all around them. Interesting. So even if say nothing happens, well, that's going to just cause a very severe tension to build up, right? Also, especially if you live on the West Coast, you're going to say, "Hey, nothing's happening, and we may have to move, get out of here, leave. Maybe be a ghost town, or maybe we just put all the anarchists and let them live in San Francisco Bay Area or something." And how I learned to love the bomb, so to speak. Yeah, if they love it, and maybe that's the way it is already here. Maybe they're suicidal, and that's why they all live here. Quite possible. They really seem to have a suicidal complex. And so they may be inviting the bomb. Yeah, please, please take us out of our misery. Maybe that'll help us. We feel something's wrong, but we don't know what it is. Well, it's called gross stupidity, and it's called your education. And it's called your karma. That's what's wrong, but it's treatable. You don't need to treat it with a nuclear bomb on your head, folks. It's very treatable. Very, very treatable. So it may be just that, really. Because I cannot figure these people out. That makes more sense than anything. The people who are trying to prevent that from happening, they hate them. They said they're terrible, they're evil, they're wicked, we must get rid of them. And they trust in North Korea, Kim, the North Korean. They think, well, he's reasonable, I think he's pretty reasonable. They must be suicidal. What else can you say? What else can you say? Any person who's merely stupid can look at the situation and say, no, Kim is not reasonable. He's a nutcase. To say the least, to say the least. And the North Koreans are really, really have severe mental problems. And that's putting it mildly. So I think these people who try to, look at that, yeah, I think he's probably the better of the two, and we can trust him more, and there shouldn't be any problem, and they're suicidal. A lot of these are the same people that are taking assisted suicide as they get older. They're looking forward to that. Wow, maybe that'll cure what's wrong with me. I finally have an excuse to kill myself. Unfortunately, a lot of these folks, they call themselves liberals, but they're not. They're really anarchists. They really are suicidal. But society doesn't condone that, so they're trying to find a way around that. And one of them is assisted suicide. Here, it's finally passed in California. I think it's been true, Oregon, Washington, I'm not sure, but I think some of the West Coast is kind of assisted suicide friendly, to say the least. And I know a lot of people are really looking forward to that. I say, my God, what kind of cocktail am I going to have? Finally I get to drink that cocktail. I just hope I get cancer at some point so I can drink that cocktail, and that'll just knock out whatever is wrong with me. Yeah, they're thinking about praying, about focusing on the afterlife, about, well, they might do some of that, but really, in the back, and I brought this up, in the back of their mind, say, "Oh boy, morphine, yeah, great. How many drugs can I take? That should kill me really nicely." So that showed up, tips their hand. It tips their hand. You can see it all sorts of ways. They're very suicidal because being trapped by their education, they don't have anywhere to turn. They don't have anywhere to turn because they think they're the smartest people in the world, and they've had the best education in the world, and so that's the only place they can turn to, which, of course, that all that does is camouflage and their gross stupidity, and doesn't give them any help at all. So they really feel helpless and hopeless. So that causes them to be suicidal. So they're trying to find a way around, the prohibition against suicide. So if they get sick enough, they can have their drug cocktail, and if Kim drops nuclear ICBMs on them, that'll take care of it too. And they're thinking that might even do the job even better, incinerate the evil that is dogging them, you know, but guess what? Habits travel. They even travel beyond the grave. They most certainly do. So it doesn't get rid of it. It will not get rid of it. But therapy, right therapy, will get rid of gross stupidity. Absolutely will. I've done it, and many have done it. And, you know, welcome to stupidity. Yeah, it's a whole new land. It's a wonderful land where you're able to, you're aware, like really clearly aware, hey, that was stupid. That was stupid. And I can fix that. I know how to fix that. And you can dissipate stupidity rather rapidly. It's wonderful to be just merely stupid. Absolutely it is. Death doesn't have any value. I can't even die. I can never even die. That's true. I can never really die at all. I can never die. So this is, you know, we're just peeling back some of the ugly layers here, the rotten layers, to see what's underneath. And as we do that, we say, wow, okay, this is coming into focus better here. Really, I think the folks in Berkeley, you know, I mean, they'd probably welcome a bomb. I say at least it's a Stalinist bomb. You know, maybe they think that's like a benediction, like it's holy water. It'll be holy radiation for them. And that'll sanctify them somehow. But, you know, raise the issue of the United States trying to stop it, and they're like foaming, you know, rabid dogs foaming at the mouth. You know, try to do something to prevent anarchy in the world, and it's like they think that's the worst thing imaginable. Anarchists are just looking for suicide, basically. They just hope that something random, something will happen, and it'll take me out. Finally, I don't want to do it myself. You know, what are they looking for? What are they looking for, really? Yeah, civilization is difficult. It offers us the opportunity to start get some therapy, actually, and to practice presence. But in anarchy and chaos, how could you practice presence under those circumstances? No, it's a pipe dream. It's a pipe dream. I know we romanticize anarchy, like thinking, oh, in the midst of the battle, I suddenly had this presence and stuff. You know, there's a few people that romanticize it like that. But that's a pipe dream. You know, it's really a stupid pipe dream to promote it like that. I think there was someone in the Korean War, was it William Samuel from the United States, sort of a non-dualist type that And during the Korean War, there's snipers and bullets flying, and he had this moment where he just, I guess it was just all disassociated from it, and he went into some spirit, had some spiritual breakthrough or something. But that is very, 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 very unlikely and rare. And that should never be promoted, that's the way. No, the way is the way I've done it, is in a peaceful, quiet, suburban setting, where there was no demands on me at all, hardly, no crime, you know, things. It was just boring. People are very civilized, and everyone minded their own business, and I was able to just concentrate on gross stupidity and gradually, you know, change my expectations, so I didn't expect to be grossly stupid anymore. That's the way to do it. You know, monasteries, spiritual—that does that. You know, that's just like, I mean, the suburb is like a monastery. It's so quiet. It's so peaceful. Nothing's happening. There's no culture. There's no, really, where I've lived. I mean, it's got to be one of the most boring places in the world. If you don't want to do anything, there's nothing to do. If you want to be supremely bored, this is it. This is the place. But if you want to work on your gross stupidity, it's also the place. Because there is zero street life. There is nothing going on after 6 o'clock or so. I mean, there is nothing. Everyone leaves to go to work, comes back and disappears in their house, and there's nothing going on in the street at all. Nothing. Nothing, nothing, nothing's going on. You have to really, really work hard to find anything at all. And it's not worth the effort. So basically, most people, I don't know what they do. They go to bed early, they watch television, go to bed, and get up early and work and try to make their millions. Mow the lawn on weekends. That's about it. And go on vacations. But if you can't afford to go on vacations, you're here, there's nothing to do. Nothing to do. Go, watch movies, basically. Watch movies, play video games, get on Facebook. The internet kind of saved us from boredom, but I already had saved myself by studying A Course in Miracles. So, and spending my time in a dharmic way of working on my gross stupidity every day, every day, every day, every day. You could use drugs, you can get into all sorts of stuff. But where does that get you? It doesn't work. So yeah. That's how you do it. You don't do it through anarchy. You don't do it through war. The idea that wartime affords you some great opportunity to make spiritual breakthroughs is really romanticized nonsense. Dangerous romanticized nonsense. It's really the last place you want to find yourself. I mean, you can suffer sleep deprivation and battle fatigue and go into a dissociative episode, and you can you lose the personality, so to speak. But that's only if you're like super mature, dharmically mature, could such a thing be beneficial to you. So if somebody if that happened for them is because they were very dharmically mature. But for the rest of us, PTSD. It is, devastates people right now. I meet so many veterans that have PTSD. Someone told me every veteran has it. From the Vietnam War and the Korean War, Vietnam War, Iranian, well, not Iranian, Iraqi War, Kuwait, Iraq, the Gulf Wars. They have PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. Yeah, I've spoken with them, and I said, "How you doing?" He says, "Well, it's a constant battle. I'm doing a little better, but." It gets me at times. It gets me. And it's kind of scary. It's kind of scary when they have it. I had a talk with somebody like that, and he was telling me. And I said, "Well, I meditate." He said, "Yeah." I said, "What do I? Well, I do. I meditate. That's what how I do." And he says, "Yeah. I need to. I need to do that." And but, wow, you see him, and you realize something isn't quite right. Now, after World War II, a lot of veterans had it too, but it wasn't recognized at that point. So basically, you just have cocktail hour every evening is how they treated it. Hey, wee wee, the Rat Pack. This would be like the Rat Pack. So Sinatra, Sammy Davis, and Dean Martin. Let's cocktail hour every evening, and let's just keep it going too. Let's keep it going right through. And they basically, self-medicated with alcohol and heavier stuff. And a lot of them suicided. I listened to quite a few people testify to me that their childhood was horrific, was absolutely horrific. Their dad was suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, and they got beaten, they got treated savagely, because they would freak out. They said they mentally were monsters, absolutely deranged, but. They were just assimilated back into society and stuck out in the suburbs. And a lot of the complaints that women had, which gave rise to one of the well, is a suppose it was an excuse that feminism used, but there were a lot of troubles that women experienced because their husbands were suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, and they did get beaten, and they did go through a lot of hell because of it. No question about it. And they're wondering, what can I do? What can I do to help? I mean, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. Yeah. Bad situation. Tough situation, right? A lot of the guys, they had to keep moving around. It's dangerous to be and stay in one place too long. I got to move, got to move. So America becomes very mobile, moving all over the place. Because in war, if you stay to one place too long, you're a target. So the idea is you got to make progress. You got to take any, take out this enemy area and this enemy area and advance, 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 and don't become a moving target's harder to hit. And so they're very restless. They were smoking, eating steak, drinking like crazy, moving around. But for me, I've stayed in the same place my whole life. I don't feel like I need to move it around at all. Except at this point, it'd be nice to get out of here. if you got an ICB, a nuclear ICBM coming at you, maybe you might want to move. But my mindset was very different, very dharmic, very sattvic. Let's just meditate, contemplate. This is good enough. Let's practice presence right where we are. But the generation that went through World War II, Korean War, Vietnam War, they have a different outlook. They're restless. They want to keep moving and advancing and, seizing success and money and property. Well, I need to accumulate. We need to, meaning we need to take the territory the enemy had. We need to take it over and end this war. It's kind of like the endless war in this world, isn't it? It gets passed on to the children. So a lot of people my age suffered badly. I suffered badly. My dad suffered from post-traumatic stress disorder. No doubt about it. He went through hell in World War II. Very nerve-wracking. And when he got too tense and things got, when he couldn't move, he started to go crazy. Yeah, he if when he was moving and doing something, he felt safer. It's like I gotta fly out of this dangerous place. I got in this dangerous place. I gotta get out of here. I gotta get to a safer place. So there's always that feeling, I gotta get to some safer place. So we were always on. It was never we never he was always up and move, do this. And for me, I was the opposite. I just wanted to contemplate. So there's a conflict there. Pretty amazing how the hell that we go through in this world. Just listening to people, and you just boy, who doesn't have a hellish story? I hear so many. It's unbelievable. People realize that I won't, judge him for it. I have some. They're thinking maybe he has a remedy. Maybe that's why. Well, I do have the remedy. No question about it. I have the remedy. Is you go from gross stupidity to stupidity, and then from stupidity, there's a way then to actually get even free of even stupidity, which is this new way of very advanced. Like I'm absolutely completely worthless. Wow, and just sit there without doing anything at all, and just feel. That's like great medicine. I can just feel. That's like super spiritual medicine. Super, super helpful. So that actually frees you from stupidity, but you don't do this practice when you're trying to get free of gross stupidity. Okay, so let's make it very clear. You don't do this type of practice when you're trying to get free of gross stupidity, because that backfire on you. So this is the highest kind of practice for those who are ready to finally get free of stupidity. But first, you have to get rid of gross stupidity. That's the preparatory stage. And doing that, something like A Course in Miracles is extremely helpful. Reading through that, doing the practices, focusing on that. It's extremely helpful. I did it for 15 years, just full on, all day, just so full on. I spent massive amounts of time at it and completely immersed myself in it. And it worked. It worked. It worked. And then I got out of gross stupidity, and then I was able to go a journey beyond words. That really helped me start working on stupidity, and been working on that ever since. 20, quite a few years, right? 94, 23 years, you might say, been working on that, on stupidity. And now getting ready to really get out of that altogether, actually. So the new way is for those who are very dharmic, and being very dharmic means they've admitted they're grossly stupid. They cannot tolerate that. We must get free of that. They've worked to get into stupidity now, and they're just merely now stupid. That's being very dharmic. If you're just merely stupid, very few people in this world are merely stupid, very few, and even fewer are free of stupidity. Very rare that that's the case. Very rare indeed. But it will become more common as we take this new way that Jesus has helped us with. Quite a few of us will be free of stupidity, actually. Quite a few of us. Because just saying this, I have no value whatsoever. I'm completely worthless. I will always be completely worthless. Just using that is really, really going to liberate you from all stupidity. quickly, quickly. That's a fast path by doing that. Really fast. I can feel it. I know the difference. I can tell. And I say, wow, that is powerful medicine. We have this super powerful medicine now for these times. We have it. We have it. Prior to any, whoops, prior to any, you know, World War III starting, we have it. We absolutely have it. So we're in great shape. We're in great shape. And that's the whole purpose of this great push, is to be in great shape prior to all hell breaking loose. And it's all hell is likely to break loose at any moment, or it could not. Also, it depends on how repentant the world decides to become. Maybe doing these videos helps greatly, actually, by just saying, you know, there absolutely is a way. We don't need World War III. We don't need it. Absolutely don't need it. We can back away from the abyss. We can all get into therapy. We can all start tackling gross stupidity. And from there, it comes up roses for us. No question about it. When you tackle gross stupidity, you're on the winning track. 100% on the winning track, and you know it. And once you get to the stupidity, you realize you can't be stopped. You cannot be stopped. And we can all do that. We can all do that. So I'm certainly pleading that everybody do that. And the North Koreans can do it. All right? They can get into therapy, and they can come out of it. Because I've been through anything they're in and worse, and totally come out of it into just mere stupidity and getting free of that even now. So I'm totally confident that every single aspect of oneness that we call North Koreans can absolutely come out of the troubles that they have, the mental troubles, the gross stupidity. Absolutely every single one of them without exception. Same with everyone in the world. There's not one of us that cannot come out of it and graduate into mere stupidity. Not one of us. Totally confident about that. Without a single exception. Without one exception. We're all capable of it. I've proven it. I know for a fact that it can be done, and the tools are there. But once you use the tools, you're going to succeed without question. Once you decide to do it and put yourself and determine, you will succeed. And the Holy Spirit will absolutely support you every step of the way. And you will get tremendous, tremendous orchestration of your path, so that beyond what you can imagine. So you're way more successful than you could imagine. Right now you're thinking, wow, it may take me forever. No, it won't. You know, and it may be super difficult. Well, not as difficult as you fear, actually. It will be difficult, yeah. But it will go quicker than you imagine. So there's no need for World War III at all. There is no need, from my standpoint, from the dharmic standpoint, there's no need at all for it. There's no need for any more conflict in the world. Now that we have this new way that clearly shows how to be liberated from mere stupidity also, and to finish the path. Now we know what we can finish what we start. So it's not a pipe dream to start tackling gross stupidity. Not a pipe dream at all. There's a way to finish it too. But first, you got to tackle this gross stupidity. And that's very interesting, actually. It really is. You'll find it way more interesting than World War III to tackle gross stupidity. Now, it's not going to sell a lot of newspapers. It's not going to sell a lot of products on television, right? Well, but we don't need all that stuff, actually. Well, once you start tackling gross stupidity, you say, I just need a simple life. You know, I've got my plate full right here in what I'm doing. I don't need all this complex culture that we have and all this materialism and stuff. No, just give me a t-shirt and a pair of jeans and I'm good. I mean, I got the book. This is all I need, really. So you become much simpler life. You're not attracted to this insane materialism that we have. And your wardrobe might become very simplified. Your food, very simplified. Everything, your whole life will become very simplified. Which those who are grossly stupid don't want, because they think that stuffing their face with money and from, you know, selling you all this junk, becoming wealthy and powerful and prosperous, you know, capitalists from all this junk, materialists. Well, socialists do the same thing, but materialists, you know, in other words, buying all these drugs, you know, from your anxiety, you know, that's making shareholders and a lot of people vastly wealthy. Well, you know, they're grossly stupid. They don't need that. They have to tackle their gross stupidity too. Maybe nobody buying any more of that stuff might wake them up a little bit. We don't need to keep growing the GNP, you know? Nobody needs to keep growing the GNP. Let's downsize the GNP all around the world. We don't need all this money circulating. It's nonsense. We just need a few good books. That's really all we need. A Course in Miracles is one of them. Just that's what, for me, that's all I needed. When I was studying, I don't need anything else. I really didn't need anything else. Just a little bit of food and some shelter. But even that, I could have done in a hammock or something under a palm tree. Just, you know, just leave me alone. Let me study this. Let me pay attention to this. That's it. I didn't need any culture, actually, at that point. You could do it on a desert island. Absolutely, you could. In fact, I would have welcomed that. So the suburbs here was a desert island, actually. But really, you don't really care where you are when you're doing it. Do it in a cave, on a desert island or something, as long as you got some water and a few coconuts, and spend a couple decades at it. And by that time, you know, you're no longer going to be grossly stupid. You're going to be really trending out of that. Now, the echoes are still there, will still be there. You know, you're trending out of it, and you can, you feel like, yeah, I'm out of it, but, you know, you want to get far, far away from it. So that takes a while to get far away from gross stupidity. But, you know, really, you're out of it. You can get out of it like that. And then you have to keep working to make sure you don't go back to it. That's, and then get out of stupidity, mere stupidity. Get out of that ultimately also. But once you get out of gross stupidity, you realize you're never going back to it. You're never going back to it. There's no way you can go back to it. And we can all do this. Everyone in the world can do this. Everyone. If they decide to. But if the world should decide to have World War III, then leave us out of it. You know, leave the ones who want to tackle their gross stupidity, leave them out of it. They have a right to be left out of it. We have a right to not be bothered by it if we decide really, truly, and decide to do this. Everyone who decides to do it really has the right to not really pay any attention to World War III, because they need their attention fully on the means to work on gross stupidity. And again, it's not really helped if they're in a battle zone. That doesn't really help. Again, you can have dissociative experiences, but getting out of gross stupidity really requires very steady determination and smoothing things out. It's not such something that can be worked on properly in a battlefield. Jesus was asked in Dialogue on Awakening by Tom and Linda Carpenter. Tom asked him, hey, is it possible that those who move beyond the physical form and have no more, you know, attachment to it, realize it has no value? Like, for instance, yourself, I mean, is it, talking to Jesus, is it possible that you can appear back in this world and have a physical appearance like you did there after the, you know, you did at the resurrection, as you appeared to the apostles and many others? Jesus said he appeared to very many, 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 actually, not just the apostles. And Jesus said, of course. And he said, actually, it's very, very simple and easy to do. And he said, you might think it's difficult, but from our standpoint, very simple and easy to do. And he says, of course we can do this. Would you do it? Yeah, if it's called for. I don't know if that was in the book or not, but I might have put it there. But certainly, Jesus' whole tone was, piece of cake, piece of cake. Of course we can. Well, I would ask Jesus then, if it's that easy, and we're getting free of stupidity, isn't it just as easy for us to have an appearance in some other place other than this world? Wouldn't that also be a piece of cake? And the answer would be probably pretty self-evident, right? I mean, so let's generalize this answer Jesus gave. Say, wait a minute. If it's a piece of cake, and Jesus says from a certain perspective, that's so easy to do, actually. You can just appear in a world of the body, any world you want. I mean, Jesus wants to appear. He says, yeah, of course. Well, I mean, is this the only place in the whole universe that anyone would want to appear in? That's kind of doubtful, isn't it? It's more than extremely doubtful, right? It's absurd to think that this planet is the only place that happens to that you anyone would want to appear in. I mean, actually, this is the place very few would want to appear in. Only those who are grossly stupid want to appear in this world, actually, unless you're trying to help out. But there's probably many, many places, maybe almost trillions, who knows, in the universe. There could be a trillions of places that are like better than this world. You'd much rather appear in those places. Even if there were billions or hundreds of millions, etc. Right? I mean, so if it's a piece of cake, as Jesus insists it is, why can't we just appear in some other realm? Have an appearance there. Piece of cake. Absolutely easy, Jesus says. No trouble at all. For him to appear here? Well, as he says, that he's no different than we are. There's only the one mind. And so if the one mind can do that here, the one mind can should be able to do it anywhere, right? Should be able to do it anywhere. So maybe if World War III really does break out, maybe we'll just appear somewhere else. Those who want to work on their gross stupidity, and those who are merely stupid, and those who are not have free of stupidity, maybe we'll all just decide, you know what, let's appear somewhere else. And Jesus could certainly facilitate that, as he says, a piece of cake. Well, he could certainly, if we trust and have faith in him, he could certainly make it into a piece of cake for us, couldn't he? And let those who want to keep on denying gross stupidity and thinking that they can somehow be, the alpha dogs of gross stupidity, and that'll make them happy, let them have their fun here, right? Leave us out of that. That's a little too much fun for us at this point. Or it's not, it's just, it's kind of like it's not my kind of fun. Yeah, maybe it's fun, but it's not my kind of fun. We're not going to deny them to say there's a lot of people here that think that conflict and war and violence, that's really fun for, they think that's fun. They got it tattooed all over their body like this. Yeah, they play these video games. It's fun, 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 until your daddy takes the T-bird away, so to speak, until it's not fun anymore. But so let's not deny it could be fun for the one spirit, one mind. But let's say, yeah, but right now it's not my kind of fun. Because I'm having to focus on this gross stupidity thing, and that's really fun. That's my kind of fun right now. And believe me, as difficult as it was unbelievably fun. The intensity was so amazing that it was astonishing, and it still is astonishing. And so for me, when you talk about intensity, if you really love intensity, there's nothing more intense than tackling gross stupidity. That's it. That's it. So all these people that think we have World War III, it's really intense, they don't even know what intensity is. They're very feeble, They lack a spirit of adventure. They're kind of deficient in that, actually. They think that yeah, this is where it's at. Wow, look at this global conflict. This is amazing. That's nothing. That's nothing compared to tackling gross stupidity. There's nothing compared to it. It's like being in a coma compared to tackling gross stupidity. It's like saying, wow, this is so intense. I'm in a coma. I'm not even aware of intensity, but wow, that's really cool. No, it's you're in a coma and you're not experiencing intensity. So global World War III, the bomb, nuclear bombs going off everything, that's nothing compared to tackling gross stupidity. That's where you really experience the intensity and just say, wow, this is like uber intense. The other stuff is just, you know, you're in a coma compared to it. And so it's really adventurous. It's super adventurous. You know, the guy that just soloed El Capitan, free climbed, no ropes, no safety equipment, nothing. He just did that El Capitan, the first guy to do it. That's still nothing compared to tackling gross stupidity. It doesn't do anything. I mean, it doesn't even touch upon it. You might say it's a grossly stupid thing to do. yeah, absolutely. Are you kidding me? And it sets pretty bad precedent for others because, I mean, he's the first person to ever be able to do that. And there's some freaks that can do some freaky stuff here. But that, should not be popularized and say, hey, you can do it. No, you can't. Most people cannot do that, will not be able to do that. They're going to slip and fall. You know, he just was like, you know, extreme anomaly, you might say, in that condition. But doing something like that doesn't touch upon gross stupidity at all. Not at all. Tackling gross stupidity, you realize you're in this very big arena, and this arena is really something else. I mean, you say, holy cow, this is going to challenge me all to the depths, you know, and I'm going to need help with this. You don't free climb out of gross stupidity. You need the Holy Spirit to help you, and you need safety ropes, and you need, you know, getting out of that pit is quite something. And ultimately, you get wise enough to say, now, wait a minute. I'm really stupid. You say, wait a minute, you know. Am I really in the pit? And you start asking yourself that. And then ultimately you realize that there's not even any pit at all. The pit's completely flat. How can there be a flat pit? We're just wishing. We're sitting on the ground wishing there was a pit there, but there isn't. Meaning, there's no time-space processor form. There's no pit of time-space processor form. Everything is just a now. It's completely flat in terms of any time-space processor form or structure. There's no structure at all. There's no structure at all. No such thing as structure, actually. So ultimately, you know, we come to see that more and more. Structure is an illusion. Nothing ever crystallizes. It's wishful thinking that we're projecting as our perception. So getting to that, you know, wow, what a trip that is. You know, it makes everything else seem very, very pedestrian. You know, it makes acid trips seem very, very pedestrian. Okay. It makes world wars look very pedestrian. Like nothing to see here. How boring, you know, how boring. It makes all the drug stuff so boring. All the sex, drugs, and rock and roll, it's so boring. It's so pedestrian. It's just something for anarchists to dabble in, you know, as they try to figure out, you know, how to be suicidal. You know, forget that stuff. The tackling gross stupidity is so interesting that you don't want to commit suicide at all. And say, wow, I got to see how this turns out. This is absolutely astonishing. That I didn't realize that my mind could actually look at this and look at that synchronicity and look at this. How did that happen? The synchronicities, and it's like, wow, wow, wow. And it's just like a continuous wow. You're on this ride that you didn't even know this ride existed. And you say, oh, this is amazing. I don't know what's going to go. What's around the bend? This is so incredible. What a ride I'm on. And it's the greatest ride there is. Until we're completely free of all stupidity, and then we can't even speak of the right at that point. No need to either. No need to even consider it. It's inconsiderable, if that's a word. unconsiderable, inconsiderable. We don't even bother. So let's do it. Let's do it. Let's everybody do it. And in the meantime, have a place of refuge. And again, let us all together, everyone together is dharmic. Let us all assert and affirm that all those who are dharmic will receive the budgeting they need at the right juncture to set aside a refuge for themselves, so that they're able to, if should things get crazy, and they're able to get away from the craziness, get away from World War III if it takes place, so they can keep focusing, realizing that no, tackling gross stupidity or stupidity is where it's at. That's what's really interesting. That's what's really cool. The rest of the stuff, very pedestrian, very unhip, very boring. And I don't want to be bored to death, okay? We have the right to defend this position, you know? Right? Yeah. And so if the turmoil gets too bad, we have a right to practice, keep practicing presence. So enough so we have a presence of mind to keep on the path, right, of tackling gross stupidity. Really, really looking at it. I'm not grossly stupid anymore. I'm barely stupid anymore, which is why Jesus, the presence of Jesus, I can be in the presence of Jesus. And he's not worried about it, you know. He says, I know I can appear to this one. It's not going to cause him trouble. Not going to really trouble him. He doesn't need to say anything. I don't need to ask him anything. I know, wow, this is intense. This is helpful to get free of mere stupidity. So, yeah. It's like a therapy session. I like therapy with Jesus. You know, I said, Jesus, let me do something for you. Talk about giving. I said, let me give you an opportunity to have a client. You can do therapy. Let me give you an opportunity to be a therapist. I'll be your client. That's a gift of love right there. Because, I mean, what are you going to do if you're Jesus? I mean, you're here to help. You're here to help. So agreeing to be his client, his therapy client, that's helping Jesus out. I imagine that he, you know, it's like, hey, I love this, you know, what a great opportunity. Why can't we give Jesus that opportunity? Why should we deny him that opportunity? If you're a great therapist, what do you want to do? You want to give great therapy to great clients. And so why withhold that from him, you know? Why not give that to him? Give that present to him, that gift to him. That's the gift I can give to him after all the help he's given me and given many. So let's have therapy, you know, once a week or something like that. Well, I'll just maybe just be silent. It'll be just silent. I had therapy once with a therapist, a Jesuit therapist, psychiatrist. I don't know how long it was, a year or two or something. And I never said anything. It was just quiet the whole time, silent. I never said anything. He never said anything. he was just quiet. I came in and he just sat there. And I just sat there and I didn't have anything to say. And finally, he ultimately says, I have nothing I can do for you. I can't help you. Well, what do you mean? You've helped me vastly. He helped me vastly. Maybe he didn't know that. Yeah, maybe he didn't know that. Vastly helpful. Because I realized I could be quiet with a psychiatrist. I didn't need to say anything. I didn't say, hey, doc, you know, let me talk about my problems, my dreams. I said, well, you know, hey. I mean, the psychiatrist really have anything to say to me? Not really. I don't really have the problems you think I have. I'm getting free of gross stupidity. That's the struggle I'm involved in. They didn't understand. You know, we think you have, you know, problems. I said, no, my problem is gross stupidity, and I'm getting free of it. It's just really tough. That's all. But maybe if people just, you know, were supportive of that, that'd be great. It'd be easier. So, no, I didn't. I just came. And I just sat. Just sat there in a chair in a small room, and basically, didn't say anything. We just sat there for an hour, and he was just quiet, didn't say anything. But he expected me to say something, I guess. He was just waiting for me to say something. I never said anything. So I can do this, you know. Jesus, I can sit there and not say anything, believe me. It may be tempting. You got Jesus there. You might want to ask him something, but I don't have to say anything. Maybe that's super effective therapy. Fun stuff, huh? You see how fun this, all this effort is? Get free of gross stupidity, and then after that, get free of stupidity. And don't put the cart before the horse. You can't get rid of mere stupidity until you've gotten rid of gross stupidity. And so many are grossly stupid in this world who have this academic education, they're very facile with words and concepts. They think that maybe they're just maybe a little bit stupid. And so they think that they should be able to do the highest teaching right away. You know, that, oh yeah, I can understand these concepts and words, and I should be able to do that. Get rid of just a little tinge of stupidity I might have still, you know. That, you know, it's putting the cart before the horse. They haven't even started with their gross stupidity yet. And because their training is so arrogant, it doesn't allow them to be humble enough to even do that. I say, no, I got A's on all my tests. Yeah, but the content was meaningless that you got A's on was meaningless. It had nothing to do with getting free of gross stupidity. You haven't even taken one single test yet in that arena at all. How have you tested yourself in that arena? Untested. So that's a problem in this world right now. Everybody wants this fast food. Like, give me the highest teaching right now. You know, I should be able to do it. Okay, yeah, I get it. Right? I mean, You could explain to people, what's Sog Chan? I'll explain. Oh yeah, I get it now. I get it. To get what? How to pronounce the words? How to put the words together? Okay, you put this word, you pronounce this word like this, and you pronounce this word like this, and you put those two words together like that, and this sort of structure. I get the structure and the pronunciation, yeah. I got an A. An A for effort. Right? So, you know, where's my diploma? Where's my diploma? I don't know. Maybe Kim Jong-un, you know, whatever, what's his name? Kim Jong-un or something. Maybe he has your diploma. You know, maybe you need to go to him for your diploma. Maybe because maybe he thinks he's pretty smart too. Right, birds of a feather flocking together. You know, these folks that think, yeah, I can use language and I can put words together in a structure. I can, you know, I can measure stuff and then do calculations off of measurement. Man, I'm really smart. I'm not stupid. But who's this I you're talking about? An imaginary I? That you believe that that this is imaginary I? I mean, that's kind of grossly stupid. You imagine that you know. Anyway, yeah, we don't want to pour it on. I mean, let's go gently here. But and then they kind of compete. Like I got no more knowledge about the news than you do. I'm not stupid. You're the one who's stupid. So I should be giving you a grade, you know. That's what it's like, isn't it? It's just madness here. And you say, well, you know, you're grossly stupid. Now, if they're insulted by that, then they're not dharmic at all. Or if someone calls me grossly stupid, it is, what do I care what they say? It makes no difference to me. That, you know, it doesn't affect me at all. I've already put myself through the fire and a test and all that. And so they can't drag me back into it. It's like saying nothing. So Their sensitivity betrays their gross stupidity. When you're grossly stupid, you're very sensitive and very nervous about it. You're very like, wow, I'm very insecure about it. They don't want anyone saying anything like that to them. A lot of the ETs are that way. They're grossly insecure, so insecure. They always have to be toadied to, oh, you're so wonderful, you're so smart, you can calculate the orbit of the planet, oh my God, you're so smart, yeah, you're wonderful, you're so smart. You can do some calculations. Oh, but our computer models were off. Everything got messed up. Gee. Who did that code anyway? It wasn't me. Some idiot over there coded, not me. Oh, you're doing trusted in computers and code to, what is that? Isn't that grossly stupid right there? So they're really sensitive. Oh my gosh, The senors and senoritas don't say anything like, so they're, very non-dharmic still. And yet they think that they're supposed to give us the grade us, like they're capable of grading us on what? On what? That's how nuts it is in this world anyway. So, pretty funny, except when they claim that they're here to grade you. That's not so funny. It's pass-fail. It's not a grade, it's pass-fail. And if you can't say, I'm absolutely worthless, I will always be absolutely worthless, and say, yeah, that's music to my ears, I love hearing that. If you can't say that, then you still haven't passed at all. Not even close to passing, still in the fail mode. I need do nothing, as Jesus says, just that. If you can say just that, I need do nothing. He says, but you can say that and it feels very positive to you and you don't feel any resistance. He says, you're extremely close to passing, yeah. Passing out of stupidity for good, for forever. I mean, you're not going back to it. I mean, you could if you wanted to, but probably decide that you don't really want to do that. So that's an easy way. It's a test right there. It's an easy test. Apply that test. So you can apply it to yourself. All about dharmic path is applying these tests yourself to see where you stand. I was always trying to see where I stand. Like, am I getting nervous about this? Does it bother me? This? I'd say, okay, I got more work to do. And at this point, applying these, saying this stuff, I say just like, wow, yeah, I love it. It's music to my ears. I've never heard anything so wonderful. I am absolutely worthless. I will always be absolutely worthless. I will always be have no value whatsoever. And I'm saying like, ah, that's the most beautiful music I've ever heard. Absolutely fabulous. There's no music that sounds as sweet as that. So that means, wow, obviously made a lot of headway. So when someone tries to put you down, say you're so worthless. I say, yeah, I'm completely worthless. Thanks for reminding me. They look at you like, oh my God, you're crazy. Yeah, no, you're virtually sane, actually. What a worthless piece of junk. Yeah, completely worthless piece of junk. And not only that, but it will always be a completely worthless piece of junk. I will always be a completely worthless piece of junk. In fact, it's a zero. I'm a complete zero. Always will be a total zero. I will always be a total zero. Very factual statement. Very factual statement. So welcome to the new way. It's an amazing way, isn't it? And I'm feeling the juice from it now. It's like, hey, yeah. coming out of the doldrums. It's funny, Sri Srinath Maimash used this instrumentation, this young girl doing these dips, and I got it. I'm going to go through some dips. I tried to figure out what's going on. I know it's very important. And I have. I've gone through some dips, some low spots. But as you do a dip, you know, you push back up, push down, push back up. And so I hit some few low spots recently, and it was pretty drastic, you know, but I just said, okay, I'll bounce back from this for sure, no doubt about it. And just asked the Holy Spirit for help, and the Holy Spirit gave me the new way, and I said, this is for me, absolutely, hallelujah, this is for me, this is great, I love it. Not everybody will love it, but some of you who are far along, you kind of say, I can probably learn to love this. I can probably love this at some point, but I can't quite love it yet, but it's coming. You feel that way. You can say, intuitively you say yes, but I'm not, you know, quite, I sort of cringe. I'm still cringing, a little cringe reaction still. For me, no, there's not the cringe reaction. It's like, hallelujah, I want to be out in the streets dancing. As a matter of fact, I'd like to learn to dance a little bit, and maybe I will if God willing, maybe I can do a little dancing, you know, dance with happiness. Like I'll do the completely valueless dance. I'm a complete zero dance. I don't know exactly how that dance goes, but maybe we can work it out. Holy Spirit, so helpful in so many ways, even in pragmatic ways. I had to get a three wood. I said, this course that used to be my home course, I stopped playing it. Because really, this is just a cool down period right now. Okay, so let's sort of relax on the intensity. And we'll just blah, blah, blah about golf. You know, what else? You know, golf lends itself to blah, blah, blah. This course, I was thinking about this course, and it really takes the driver out of your hands. There's really no way to play it with a driver unless you are just, you know, Greg Norman-esque. You hit it just long and straight, and you got either a baby draw or a power fade, and you do it just virtually every time. If you can't do that, you can't play this course with a driver, and it just kills everybody. And I was looking at it, and just realistically, I said, yeah, you cannot play it. And the slightest mistake, you are just going to eat it really bad. It's going to ruin your round. This course is notorious for ruining your round. You maybe go along for a while doing great, and then before you know it, bam, 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 and you're on the ground. You know, triple bogey here, triple bogey there, double bogey here, and before you know it, your round's ruined. You can't have any loose shots, and you have to drive it long and straight if you want to really take on the course. So I said, I can't do that. You know, almost hardly anybody can do that. So the only other way to play the course is with a three wood for most of the holes. First hole, third hole, really the fifth hole, seventh hole, ninth hole, 11th hole, 14th hole, 15th hole, and really the 18th hole. All of those you should hit a three wood, unless you're just the master of the driver. You should hit a three wood. But the problem is that the greens are so diabolical that unless you're hitting a short iron into these greens, you're going to be three putting all day long, if not four putting. Okay, seriously. I mean, good luck two putting if you're hitting a long iron or hybrid into these greens. You know that you're going to be three putting. So that ruins your round right there. So you have a dilemma. So if you play with a three wood, you can stay out of a lot of trouble. You have to get it straight, you know, but you can stay out of some of the trouble. But then you've got hybrids into the greens. A lot of the greens are longer irons, and that puts you, you know, behind the eight ball on the greens. So the course is very diabolical, actually. It's very diabolical. The only way to really tame that course is you just be the master of the driver, or you really can crush your three wood or three iron, really crush it. And it's easier to keep that straight, you know, that's the idea. And so you hit your 3-wood far. But the problem is, for me, like a normal 15-degree 3-wood, let's say it's 15.5 or something like that. It's too hard to hit it far. You don't hit it far enough. It goes too high. The loft is too high. So I was saying, how can I really have a good golf game under those kind of conditions without being able to hit the 3-wood? Like, I need to hit it like 230 or something like that. And with this kind of loft of a normal 3-wood, a lot of times you won't hit it that far. It'll go too high, it'll balloon on you, especially if it's windy. You might end up like 210, 220. You can't really get out there at 230, 240, what you really need to do, so you can have like a shorter iron, like an 8 iron into the green, instead of hitting like a 6 iron. It makes a great difference hitting 8 irons compared to a 6 iron on these greens. 8 iron, you might be able to get it up close enough to 2 putt. 6 iron, you probably won't. So another extra 20 yards off the tee with a 3-wood is really important here. It makes all the difference. So I know that. I'm wise enough to know that. So I said, but I don't know what to do. I mean, I don't have the answer. Well, the Holy Spirit directed my attention to something that blew my mind. And it's amazing how it did it. But it did it. I came across this 3-wood, but it said 3-4. 3-4. I said, what are you talking about, 3-4? Well, it's adjustable lofts. And I didn't know that 3-woods had adjustable lofts as well, could have adjustable lofts as well. I hadn't heard of that before. It's not as well known, I think. Most people don't realize you can adjust this club from 12 to 15, de 15 degrees, I believe. 15.5 or something. So you could de-loft it to almost a driver. I mean, 12 is like almost like a highly lofted driver. And there you go. I mean, you can put a 13, 5 or something, and there you're going to get the extra yardage. And so you can go from like a sort of they call it 3-4, but it's really like 2-3. Like a 2-wood up to a 3-wood is what it really is. You can de-loft it down to a 2-wood, like a 12, 13, that's a 2-wood, actually. So it's kind of mislabeled. It says 3-4, but a 4-wood is really like 16.5. But it doesn't go up, I don't think it goes up as high as 16.5. I think it's like 15.5, which is really kind of a normal 3-wood. But anyway. And the reviews on it, I would say, it just, this thing's a cannon. It absolutely hits it long. So I jumped at it. I found a, got a, found a used one. And I said, this is the answer I've been looking for. Amazing. I never even knew this was possible, that the adjustable 3-wood. Amazing. And I took a huge weight off my shoulders, pragmatically. I said, now there's no course that I can't play, actually. If it's wide open, I can crush the driver. If it's diabolical, like many courses these days seem to be, especially in Northern California, throw them up in the mountains, you know. I could hit a 3-wood off the tee. Right? Problem solved. And you have to know what the course is like and adjust it beforehand. You know what kind of loft you want in the 3-wood. If you want to hit it short 3-woods, and adjust it like it's up to 15. If you need to hit it a little longer 3-woods, adjust it down to 13, or something like that. You can't. It's not kosher. You can't adjust it during the round. That's not allowed. You have to set it before the round and keep it there under the rules of golf. And you know, we want to adhere to the rules of golf for the most part, from almost for every part, actually. You know, that there's some gray areas and local rules and stuff. If the fairway's just like, you know, burned out completely, you probably can adjust your lie or something under local rules or something. It's not tournament golf. You play ready golf, that's not tournament, you know, but almost everyone plays ready golf. Yeah, so there's certain things that are not quote unquote tournament golf rules, but for the most part, we play by the rules, absolutely. So no adjusting. And you're supposed to play with the same ball, brand of ball, same ball throughout your entire round. Yeah, right. You cannot change the brand of ball during your round. Like, you can't say, well, I don't want a ball that spins a lot on this hole, you know, but on this hole I want it to run out. I don't want it to spin, so I'll change the brand of ball or something. That's not allowable. But some of us do change balls just because we lose our balls and we find one on the course, say, oh, I found one, let me play this. You know, technically, that's not allowable. But yeah, that's something that nobody really sweats about it, you know, because we're not playing tournament golf. But I try to adhere to that too. If you start with like a Pro V1, you should play the whole round with a Pro V1, and you can take a ball out of play if it's cut or nicked or something like that, and you can take it out of play and say, I'm taking this ball out of play, and then you get a new Pro V1 and or whatever, and use the same brand. So you have to have some knowledge of what the course is like in order to adjust your club in the right way. I can adjust my driver up to 12, but then in the longer holes, it's just not going to work, you know. So theoretically, I could use it almost like a 2 wood, but what do you do then? But it's harder to control when you harder to control, I would think. So a 3 wood is better to control. So there's really no point in doing that. We'll see. We'll see how it works out, but the reviews are really, really great. They're saying this thing is really, really effective. If you want to use your 3 wood off the tee, it's very, very effective. A lot of the pros, they don't use a 3 wood off the tee anymore because their whole thing is just hit as far as you possibly can and then deal with the trouble. They're very good at dealing with trouble. But on some of these courses we have, you know, these jungle gyms in the mountains and stuff, you know. You're out of bounds if you start going away a little bit wayward. You know, we're out of bounds. You can't play that way. You cannot just try to hit as far as you can. These aren't parkland courses. These are courses that are gouged out of mountainsides, and you go off the too far off. You're in the in the forest. You're gone. You're down the hillside. And yes, that's it. So. You know, it's not like a parkside course, which is kind of doesn't have those issues. You know, they might have streams and rivers going through and stuff, but still in play. If you can play out of that, you can play for wherever you like the Masters. You can play from just about anywhere. The only out of bounds, I think, are on the perimeters of the course, pretty much. You know, mostly. Otherwise, it's in play. You go 2 fairways over, you could still play it. But none of these courses here that wind their way through the mountains, your ball's gone. So you got to play a different strategy there. It's not as much fun, to tell you the truth. I mean, it's kind of fun to hit it as hard as you can. And if it goes a couple of fairways over, you still got a shot. Pull out your hybrid and crush it, and maybe you get on the green. That's fun. That's a lot funner than losing your ball every time it strays away from the fairway. Now, like desert waste areas. You go in the, everywhere's just a waste area. You go in the waste area, you can find your ball somewhere, and if it's not, you know, blocked by some cactus or whatever, you know, you could find a way to hit it. It's more difficult, waste area, sure, but it's still playable. I like the fact the ball, let it still be playable. Make it more difficult, but let it be playable. Don't, you know, penalize you by the ball's lost. That's not much fun to lose, you know, 10 balls around, which a lot of courses here you could lose 10 balls. Some courses you could lose 20, actually. There's one course here, you better bring 30 balls to that golf course. If your game's off and you really try to smash it, you could lose 30 balls out there, actually. Every shot, your ball is in danger of being lost. And sometimes, you know, not really fairly at all. And so we just bring junk balls out there. You know, just bring your worst beat up golf balls because you're going to lose them. That's not really that fun. Not a lot of parkland courses around here. Not enough, actually. All these tall grasses, you go in there, it's lost. Forget it. Shrubland courses we have here. It's so thick, so thick, thick. You can't find it. You go in there looking for your ball, you'll find 20 balls in there. You probably won't find your own. It never works out that way, but you'll find 20 others. I mean, it's once it goes in there, you know, it's, forget it. Forget it. So it kind of takes some of the joy out of golf, but it's joyful just to feel, you know what, let me just absolutely hit this one as hard as I can. And, you know, if it strays, I can still find it and do something with it. I enjoy that more. I miss that. I miss that a lot. Just don't get that here anymore. I don't know. course, the problem is there is that everybody's doing that, and the golf balls are flying. You never know when a ball is going to come plunking down where you are. It can come from anywhere. Where'd that come from? So it's kind of dangerous, actually. You have all these, kooks out there just crushing it, and it's just flying off, in every which direction. You need to wear a hard hat out there, actually. Which was actually not a bad idea. I think they should make some golf hats, hard hats. Because when you're young and strong and just learn the game, etc., even when you think you know it, you're a danger to everybody out there. You're hitting the ball that's going 140 miles an hour, and who knows where it's going. It's like lethal. It really is. So that's one thing about these windy courses. There's no parallel hole, so nobody can hit you with a golf ball. So you're kind of safe. I like that part of it. So what a concept to be able to adjust, and have flexibility and not play stupid anymore. And not play grossly stupid. I'll just play stupid golf. I won't play grossly stupid golf. So I'm kind of graduating, my golf game's graduating into just being stupid. I'll be a stupid golfer. But that's way better than being a grossly stupid golfer, which most golfers are, actually. Grossly stupid. I mean, if you're just stupid, you look like a genius out there. Even though you're not really a genius, you realize you're still, I was stupid, but it wasn't grossly stupid. And you think, like, wait a minute, if I hit a driver here, I've got like about a 60% chance of getting in a lot of trouble. But if I hit a 3-wood, I have like about an 80% chance of not getting to any trouble. So then you say, well, how's my hybrid game? Can I hit it 180 onto the green? If you're hitting your hybrids well, you say, yeah, I can get up close to the green. And how much trouble is up on the green? Not so much. I think I can get it in a place where I can at least have a putt at it or something. And say, okay, let me hit 3-wood. So I've got an 80% chance there, another 80% chance of the hybrid. So you add those two up, and that's a lot better than a 40% chance than a maybe a 70% chance if you hit your driver well, 40%, and then a 70% chance, or maybe 80% chance, or 90% chance to hit on the green, let's say. But would it be that much closer? And so you start looking at the percentages, and you realize the percentages favor a 3-wood. Greatly favor it, actually. 3-wood hybrid over a driver 8-iron. Let's say that the hybrid would be like 70% chance getting on, and an 8-iron is like 80%. So 40 and 80, what's better, 40 and 80 or 80 and 70? Obviously, 80 and 70 is a much higher percentage, much better. But that only works if you can really crush your 3-wood. It only works. Otherwise, then it's kind of even percentage. It even starts evening out at that point. And then when it's even out, you say, what the heck? I want to have some fun. Let me gamble on the driver. So it pushes you. When it evens out, it pushes you into gambling. It pushes you into trouble when it starts to even out like that. So you have to have a clear advantage in hitting the 3-wood to really start going in that direction, which means you'd be able to have to hit it long. So I know what I need to do. I need to be able to hit that long. There's no question about it. And what I had before here, the 4-wood, it wasn't going long enough. It just wasn't. Too high. And then trying to hit it low, I had to compensate and everything. It was too difficult. So I'm super happy that the Holy Spirit showed me this option I have. It's an option. I didn't have to say yes, but I said yes. This obviously is the answer. Thank you very much. I'll praise the Holy Spirit to somehow getting my attention out of this. I had no idea that such a thing possibly existed. So changes my golf game into just being, ultimately getting to just merely stupid mode. Which at that point means then you can start working on really getting out of the stupidity mode, right? Which, hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's possible. In my mind, I can see how it's possible, but you got to be able to function, carry out the game plan. And of course, the golf designers, some of them are very diabolical. Yeah, they set it up so you can drive it like 240, not so much danger. But if you try to go 270, you know, it narrows and a lot of danger. And then they set the greens up so you're tempted, I need to go 270. So it really, you know, pressures you really badly. They're very diabolical. Of course, the ones who do resort courses try not to be so diabolical. That just frustrates the patrons. So every hole you got to decide, oh man, you know, this hole would be so much easier if I hit it 270. But if I don't hit it perfect, I'm going to be in a lot of trouble. So I can hit it 3 wood, but then that makes me have to hit a much longer second shot. And oh boy, you know, I need to get it close. And so you're caught in a dilemma. They put you into a dilemma, and then they're trying to see how do you handle that dilemma. And if you know, if you use a ball that's a distance ball, it doesn't spin well, then how do you hold the green with a hybrid, you know, going into it? So then you tend to go more for the driver, and that puts you in more danger. So that's why, you know, golfers want a ball that goes long but spins a lot, so they can hit it far at the 3 wood and still hold the green with a hybrid. And still has high, comes in with a lot of spin and sits softly and doesn't run through the green. So golfers are always trying to beat the designers, you know, try to find a way around the designers. The designers should be a little nicer, actually. They're killing the game. They make the courses too tough. They really kill the game. If they're going to make the green really tough, then give some area to land a long drive, for goodness sakes. I encourage you to go 270. If the green's going to be really tough, you need a short iron so it's all these plateaus and stuff, and you got to get it close or you'll two-putt. And encourage a long drive. Don't penalize a long drive on those kind of holes. That's just being, you know, too tough, really. Only like a pro would welcome such a thing, you know. It's like, yeah, I can, you know, I can... Yeah, the rest of us are saying, you know, wow, this is just punishing me. I know I'm going to really have trouble on this hole. And don't put out of bounds on a hole where you really need to really hit it far, because most of us are going to, like, slice or hook, or, you know, hook it. We swing too hard, bad stuff happens. So give us some bailout. Give us some trees that we can go into but still find our ball, you know. At least give us a chance. You know, don't put out of bounds in a hole like that and a bunch of thick shrubs where you lose your ball. That's just way, way too wicked to do that kind of stuff. So encourage us to keep playing, right? Encourage us to keep playing. Same thing with the spiritual teaching. Encourage us to keep working at it. Don't make it too difficult. So Jesus was helpful that he keep, you know, talking about in the work, not in the workbook, but in the text, you know, kept pounding on the ego. So ego's so bad. Ego's so bad. We're saying, yeah, I really want to get rid of that ego. Really good. And because that's what we needed. And so he really chastises the ego a lot. And then later on in, like, Journey Beyond Words, he says, yeah, I know I chastise the ego a lot in the Course of Miracles, but, you know, really the ego is... You know, it's just your own projections, and it's not, you know, he kind of helps give us a different perspective on it. And sort of backs away from that. So we can really start forgiving ourselves, or even believing that there was such a thing in the first place. For being so, you know, adventurous in that way. So yeah, make it. So that we can, you know, get through the material for to tackle gross stupidity. We want to have some feeling like, yeah, So I'm not giving advice to the leaders of what to do. You know, it's that's beyond me at this point. I don't. If you will recognize that all the attack you perceive is in your own mind and nowhere else, you will at least have placed its source, and where it begins, it must end. For in the same place also lies salvation. Now, in Hindu teachings, they have the Bhagavad Gita has Arjuna. You know this, or is it was Arjuna, or is that the, or is it Krishna or something? Maybe it was Krishna on the battlefield. Maybe it was Krishna. But there's a great battle, and maybe the charioteer. There's a dialogue between I think the charioteer and Krishna or something. Or should I go into battle? You know, should I do it, or should I just allow this, myself to be slaughtered, or want to be slaughtered, or whatever? It's a big dilemma. And so they try to answer that, and they says, you know, a warrior has to do his duty. And you know, do your duty, and recognize it's all karma playing out anyway. And you know, that's a big question throughout history. What do you do when you're challenged? You know, and warfare seems imminent. What do you do? Do you just sit down and say, okay, you know, slaughter me, or do you take up the sword and do your best and without any hatred or enmity towards anyone? As Jesus says, well, at least you sourced it. So he seems to indicate, Jesus here says, look, realize all conflict is really in your own mind. And work on sourcing it like that. Now, does that mean that we won't take up the sword? He didn't preclude it there. He didn't preclude it. He says, at least recognize, source it, so that way you know where to work on it. So he's not prohibiting it. Right, he's just saying, look at it this way. You know, we don't want a bunch of nuclear waste lands in this world. You know, we don't want a bunch of radiation ruining like Los Angeles area for the next 500,000 years or something. I mean, come on. I mean, you can decontaminate areas like Hiroshima and Nagasaki. People, of course, went back, lived there. A lot of radiation problems. But those bombs may have not been as bad as what could happen in the world. So, yeah, you can recover. But, you know, we don't want a bunch of radiation in the food chain. Nature, you know, come on. We don't want nuclear. That's why there's a test ban treaty on nuclear weapons. So let's stop, you know, testing all these nuclear weapons. But again, each one of us has to look and see. I don't know. I don't have the answer exactly about all this. Yeah, it's a tough question that, you know, Bhagavad Gita, I guess, if it was Krishna, what would Krishna do? You know, in this situation right now that the U.S. is faced with, the situation is a hangman's choice, almost a really tough situation. What should we do? What should we do? Well, for us, you know, I would say we need to take the new way of getting free of stupidity, and then it will be more apparent to us what to do. Maybe it's appear somewhere else. If the missiles start flying, as they could very well start flying, it's not going to take much at all at this point for the missiles to start flying, raining down somewhere, right? And it's all sorts of stuff, Armageddon really taking place. The Middle East is ripe for all that conflict there. I mean, it just, you know, it, like World War One, what it took, it just took just one little incident. Archduke Ferdinand, I think, and his wife, and their son or something, I mean, assassinated in Sarajevo. And then before too long, the entire, you know, Europe and ultimately a lot of the world was engulfed in World War One. It didn't take very much. So when the tinder is dry, it only takes a spark to set the fire aflame, and the tinder is very dry right now. question is, you know, is it, you know, no war, or is there some way to limit the damage of World War III? A lot of policymakers are looking at that way. How can we limit it? How can we make it less bad than it could be? That kind of thing. Or can we find a path to no war at all? That's the question. And if you're pragmatic, you try for no war at all. But you realize the second best option is you know, to limit it as much as possible. You don't be a complete kook and say no, it's no war or total destruction. I mean, come on. I mean, we've tried past the peace throughout history, and sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. It never seems to last, and that's because everyone in the world is grossly stupid. You can't have a lasting peace among the grossly stupid. It's not possible. It's not possible. They're too stupid to accomplish a lasting peace. The only way you can have a lasting peace in this world is if people are merely stupid, and they realize that they can get ultimately free of that stupidity. So they say, no, we want conditions to be such that we can get free of that stupidity. Otherwise, you will never have a lasting peace in this world. Never. Wow, the hour's getting late here. I need to get some dinner for some people, for someone, and the hour's getting late in the world in terms of, you know, hey, the dilemma is upon us. The dilemma is upon us, the world. And like Krishna, you know, where can you turn? Can you really, at some point you got to face the dilemma and say, wow, we have a dilemma on our hands right here. And so we recommend, fast as possible, the new way, these wonderful affirmations we have from Jesus now, from the Holy Spirit. I'm completely worthless. Wow, I always will be. I, no matter what body this I seems to be associated with, there's just this one I, actually. There's not many I's. There's one I, which is imaginary, pretend. And there's all these different bodies associated with them. So we think there's many different eyes. There's not. There's not many different eyes. There's just this one delusional trick we're trying. And that eye is absolutely worthless. It will always be absolutely worthless. Doesn't matter how many bodies we associate with it. It's the same I. It's the same egoic delusion. In every case, actually. So you get free of the I. You're what use do you have for all these different bodies? You don't have any more use for all these different bodies. These different bodies are just to confuse us about the I and its non-existence. That's all that they're for, really. They'll lose all their value if the I is completely worthless. I will always be completely worthless. A zero. The I is just nothing but a total zero. It's just a zero, 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 which is nothing at all, is it? It's just a symbol that stands for nothing at all. It doesn't exist. Non-existent. There's no absence of reality anywhere. The I stands for absence of reality. There isn't any absence of reality anywhere. None. Zero. There's no absence of reality. So the I just is just this wishful hope that there's some absence of reality somewhere, and there isn't. It's absolutely worthless. And it doesn't matter how many bodies different body forms we associate with this zero, it's still zero. Still zero. And now I must prepare a meal. Which is easy enough to do these days, right? With prepared meals and microwaves and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's okay. That's it for this one. Wow, the new way. Wow.